I'll go through each sentence, tell me whether it is clear. Okay, so it is possible indeed to question the need of positing an infinite which contains our formed universe, although this conception is imperatively demanded by our mind as a necessary basis to its conceptions, for it is unable to fix an or assign a limit, whether in space or time, or essential existence beyond which there is nothing, or before or after which there is nothing. Although, too, the alternative is a void or nihil, which can be only an abyss of the infinite into which we refuse to look. An infinite mystic zero of non-existence would replace an infinite X as a necessary postulate, a basis for our seeing of all that is to us existence. A huge sentence. Okay. I think basically what he's saying is, okay, that we are saying that the universe is infinite. Okay. We can accept very much that God is infinite, Satchidananda is infinite. But can we say that the physical universe, which we see everywhere, finite limits we see everywhere, can we say that it is infinite? He's saying it is possible to say that it is not infinite. It's possible to say that. Although when we look at it very carefully, it's very difficult to accept that there is a limit somewhere. That's basically what he's saying. Because as soon as you think that there is a limit, the question arises in our mind, what is there beyond that limit? So it's a very problematic thing, and it's an assumption you have to make. So it is possible to question, but still, our mind says that there cannot be an end, because the moment you think of an end, what is there beyond that end? How can it be that it's a zero? Something must be there. And if something is there, it goes on continuing. Okay? I think that's what he's saying. I'll read the thing again carefully and you will see it. It is possible indeed to question the need of positing an infinite which contains our formed universe. In other words, the formed universe, can it be infinite? He's saying it is possible to say that it's not infinite. In fact, science says bounded infinite. Yeah. They also have a problem with that question. Although this conception is imperatively demanded by our mind as a necessary basis to its conceptions. The mind, our normal mind, can't think of something ending somewhere. Immediately we question, what is there beyond it? Okay. That's what he's saying. And why he's explaining, in inverted, comma dash, let's say, parenthetical phrase, for it is unable to fix or assign a limit, whether in space or time, or essential existence, beyond which there is nothing, or before and after which there is nothing. Very difficult for the mind to conceive of something which is ending suddenly. Immediately the question comes up, what is there before it? What is there after it? So the idea of a limit is very difficult to accept for the mind. Although too, the alternative is a void or nihil, which can only be an abyss of the infinite into which we refuse to look. The mind has a limited capacity, and if we think of something, the alternative to that is a void or a limit. Okay? The alternative to what? The alternative to the idea that there is a fixed, the universe is finite. It's possibly saying is to question the need of a finite, an infinite. So the other thing is that if it is not finite, what is there? A void or a nihil, which can only be an abyss of the infinite into which we refuse to look. The mind in which we refuse to look means we can't go. The mind is not capable of imagining beyond that. An infinite mystic zero of non-existence would replace an infinite X as a necessary postulate, a basis for our seeing of all that is to us existence. It's a complicated sentence, but I think basically what he's saying is that the mind, when it sees the universe, it sees limits everywhere. Not in time, but even in time, science is saying there's a limit. It's possible to question. Science is saying 14 billion years ago, the universe began. So it's possible to question even time as being infinite. But the nature of the mind says, very difficult to accept that. Because immediately you say, what is there beyond it? Or if you think of the future, what is there after it? Okay. So basically the sentence is this. It's saying that although you can question the infinity of the physical universe, although you can question it, that means you can say that no, it is not infinite. It is finite. That's what science is saying. Bounded infinite. Okay. If you start from here, you'll go round, you'll end up at the same place. Okay, you cannot go on continuing forever. That's the scientific idea. Bounded infinite. We'll come back to the same place. So, the sentence is a very long one. Basically, that's exactly what he's saying, that you can logically say that I don't accept that the physical world is infinite. But if you do that, then the mind is challenging that idea. The mind says, I immediately question what is there before and what is there after. Okay? Then I go to the next sentence. When I read the summary, probably it will be clearer. But even if we refuse to recognize anything as real, except the limitless expanding infinite of the material universe and steaming determinations, the enigma remains the same. Whatever you do, the physical universe remains what it is. But even if we refuse to recognize anything as real, because he has told about the mystic zero. Okay? So, okay, I think we'll go a little more. When you see the universe, we'll go into a little more detail. When we see the universe, we see everywhere limits, forms. So, we say that it's very difficult for us to accept. It's possible to do that. Very difficult to accept that the universe is infinite because I'm seeing limits everywhere. But if you do that, then the mind is not accepting that. The mind questions what is there beyond it. So we can't look beyond this. So it's a mystery. Infinite mystery zero of non-existence. Whatever you conclude, there is a confusion and there is a problem at the mental level. But even if we refuse to recognize anything as real, except the limitless expanding finite, not that, limitless expanding finite of the material universe and its teeming determinations, the enigma remains the same. It's an enigma. The universe is definitely an enigma. Then he says, infinite existence, infinite non-being, or boundless finite. There you are. I was saying, bounded infinite, but he's using the words boundless finite, are all to us original indeterminates or indeterminables. From where is the universe coming? What is the source of that universe? It's an indeterminate. It's impossible for us to mystic. That's why it's a mystic X. Okay? An original indeterminate or indeterminable. No, the mind is not capable of ever finding out what this source is, indeterminable. Indeterminate means that it has no features. Indeterminate, no features. But indeterminable, you can never know it. You can never give features to it and you can never be known. If there are no features, we can't know it. It's very difficult. When you know something, you can say it has got weight, color, size, shape. These are the determinates. But the very difficult to imagine something which is indeterminate. Can't describe it. We can assign to them no distinct characters or features, nothing which would predetermine their determinations. Impossible to give the features to it. To describe the fundamental character of the universe as space and time or space-time. This is a scientific idea that space-time is really the same. okay, space or time separately, or space time is one, does not help us. Or even if these are not abstractions of our intelligence, which we impose on our mental view of the cosmos, the mind's necessary perspective of its picture, these two are indeterminates and carry in themselves no clue to the origin of the determinations that take place in them. There is still no explanation of the strange process by which things are determined, or their powers, qualities, and properties, no revelation of their true nature, origin, and significance. I'll do one thing. The basic idea is very simple, but I'll just read out the summary of what he's saying, and then we'll give the, in very brief, the idea that he's saying. Now, but one may question, I'm reading the summary of what he's saying, but one may question the need of postulating, hypothesizing an infinite. We need not do that. We can say that the physical world is limited. But the mind insists on it. Okay? The mind says, no, I can't imagine a finite universe. How can there be finite? What is there beyond it? If there is a finite only, the mind questions, what is there beyond that point? Even if we say only a void, still it's an infinite void. Okay? That's what he's saying. That infinite is still a mystery. How does that unknown, indeterminate, infinite produce the finite known determinants of the universe? This is the problem. Okay? From where is the universe coming? Very difficult for the mind to understand. And if you say that it is something indefinite and finite or even indeterminable, it remains a mystery to us. That infinite is still a mystery at the mental level, not at the spiritual level. Spiritual level, you can understand. How does that unknown, indeterminate, infinite produce the finite known determinants of that universe? To put it in very simple language, okay? To put it very simply in this para, what he's saying is, when we look at the tree, we see determinations. There is a fruit, there are branches, there is a trunk, there are leaves, very, very determinate things. From where is all this coming? Then if you know, you look at the seed, but in the seed, you don't see any leaves and flowers. It's an indeterminate. So this is the problem. This is basically what he's saying. How can the seed, which has no leaves, no fruits, no flowers, no bark, no roots, how does it produce all these things? So the mind is a mystery. That's exactly what he's saying in the para. Okay? I think when you put it this way, it becomes much easier to understand. Right? Is it still a problem?
Yes, that metaphor helps. The seed and the tree. Yes.
Yeah, that's right. That chapter is determinations and the indeterminable. That which is featureless. How does it produce features? What is the process by which it does? No explanation at the mental level. That's basically what he's saying. Okay?
Yes.
If you, just that's why I think, yeah, the idea of the tree and the seed becomes very clear. Everything in the tree is limited and has got features. I can describe everything. I can describe the bark. I can describe the leaf. I can say it is this shape, it is this color. Everything is determinate. Determinate means having features. So when the mind questions as to where is it coming from, in the physical world we know it's a seed. But the seed, when you look, examine it, you see that it is featureless. There are no leaves, no fruits, no flowers, nothing in it. And even this image is not a very good one, because the leaf, the seed itself, has got a shape, size, and everything. So the image is not a very good one. When you go to the spiritual level, the seed is not even shape, size, color. That's the whole problem. So when we are giving this image, you have to take it with a pinch of salt. Think of a seed which has got no form, no shape, no color, nothing. So this is what he's saying basically. Okay? It's a mystery. Archana Di,
and
yes, yeah, is it okay?
Yes, 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 it's quite clear. Yes.
Okay. So then this is what he's saying. So now we can go to the next para. The whole chapter here, determinations and indeterminable, from where is this universe coming? What is the source of this universe? Okay. It is something indeterminate. That spiritual experience tells us that. Okay. But is it also indeterminable? That's the whole question he's discussing in 40 pages. He goes into great detail. So we read the next para. Actually, it was science. So one of you will read.
Yes, yes, Rangada. I'll read here. Is it my turn? Yes. I don't know. Anyway, I'm reading. Actually, to our science, this infinite or indeterminate existence reveals itself as an energy, known not by itself, but by its works, which throws up in its motion waves of energism and in them a multitude of infinitesimals. These grouping themselves to form larger infinitesimals, become a basis for all the creations of the energy. Even those farthest away from the material basis, for the emergence of a world of organized matter, for the emergence of life, for the emergence of consciousness, for all the still unexplained activities of evolutionary nature. On the original process are erected a multitude of processes, which we can observe, follow. We can take advantage of many of them, utilize, but they are none of them fundamentally explicable. We know now that different groupings and a varying number of electric infinitesimals can produce or serve as the constituent occasion, miscalled the cause, for here there seems to be only a necessary antecedent condition for the appearance of larger atomic infinitesimals of different natures, qualities, powers. But we fail to discover how these different dispositions can come to constitute these different atoms, how they differentiate in the constituent occasion or cause, necessitate the differentiate on the in the constituted outcome or result. We know also that certain combinations of certain invisible atomic infinitesimals produce or occasion new and visible determinations quite different in nature, quality and power from the constituent infinitesimals. But we fail to discover, for instance, how a fixed formula for the combination of oxygen and hydrogen comes to determine the appearance of water, which is evidently something more than a combination of gases, a new creation, a new form of substance, a material manifestation of a quite new character. We see that a seed develops into a tree. We follow the line of the process of production and we utilize it. But we do not discover how a tree can grow out of a seed, how the life and form of the tree come to be implied in the substance or energy of the seed, or, if that be rather the fact, how the seed can develop into a tree. We know that genes and chromosomes are the cause of hereditary transmissions, not only of physical but of psychological variations. But we do not discover how psychological characteristics can be contained and transmitted in this inconstant material vehicle. We do not see or know, but it is expounded to us as a cogent account of nature process, that a play of electrons, of atoms, and the resultant molecules of cells, glands, chemical secretions, and physiological processes manages by their activity on the nerves and brain of a sphere or a plateau to produce or could be perhaps the dynamic occasion for the production of a hamlet or a symposium or a republic. But we fail to discover or appreciate how such material movements could have composed or necessitated the composition of these highest points of thought and literature. The divergence here of the determinants and the determination becomes so wide that we are no longer able to follow the process, much less understand or utilize. The formulae of science may be pragmatically correct and infallible. They may govern the practical how of nature's processes, but they do not disclose the intrinsic how or why. Rather, they have the air of the formulae of a cosmic magician, precise, irresistible, automatically successful each in its field, but their rationale is fundamentally unintelligent.
Yeah. This is exactly what we discussed, and now he is explaining that through images. Okay, then it becomes very clear. He's saying, okay, we know that oxygen and hydrogen, if we combine, we get water. Okay, but what is there in oxygen and hydrogen which indicates is there any relevance or any hint that water can be produced? Absolutely not. Okay, so this is and that's why they use the word. The divine is a magician. So they use the word thaumaturge. Thaumaturge, he uses all the time. The divine is a magician. We can't explain his magic. How he does that? Science says that, okay, shape of our nose, the color of our skin, the length of our hands, the weight, all these things are there in the chromosomes. Is that any explanation at all? Because what is there in the chromosome that gives all these things? So that's it. It's not really an explanation at all. We only know the process. Yes, from this comes. The tree comes from the seed. But how does that seed, which does not contain the tree, apparently produce the tree? That's exactly what he's saying. Okay? It's a magic. And that's why we use the word Maya. The divine is creating magic. It is his power that can do that. It's impossible for the mind to understand that. Yes, we can say, yeah, we know that the tree is coming from seed. We know that hydrogen and oxygen produces water. But how does it do that? The how and the why remain absolutely impossible for us to understand. Okay. So, basically, this is exactly what we said. So, I'll read out the summary, which now it becomes very simple. If we just see, the language is a little complicated, but we just see what the meaning is. The mystery remains unsolved and unsolvable at the mental level, mind you. The seed produces the tree, but how and why? Okay, that's why. Oxygen and hydrogen produce water, but how and why? There's a how and also a why. Why should it produce only water and not something else? The unintelligibility is our ignorance of the mind. That's all. At the mental level, it's impossible to understand this. But can we understand it in a spiritual way? When you go, then it becomes clear that it is the power of the divine. And the divine being infinite, he can do whatever he wants. But at the mental level, if we are in the realm of causality, we see to everything there's a cause and a result. A cause and a result. Okay. Now, Srimdhi is using a very interesting word in the textual. He's saying, the cause is a misnomer. Okay, he's saying that. Let me see where it is. Okay, because we can say that the chromosomes are not a cause, but they are a middle term. Okay, we can say, you can say that the chromosomes are causing the features in the body. We can say that, but we can also say that the cause is not really the chromosomes. Who has created the chromosomes? So it's a middle term. It's not the cause. It's not the ultimate cause. It's an intermediate cause. You can say that. There is something, even another cause is there even higher up, which is the indeterminable. Okay. So if you want to say, in other words, you can also say the supreme, the divine is causing the universe, and the universe is causing all the forms. So when we look at the universe, we see trees, we see everything, we see seeds and trees. So the seed is explaining the tree. But what is explaining the seed? So the seed is the cause of the tree, okay. But who is causing the seed? That's what he's saying, okay. So if you look carefully, you will see. Is there? No, I'm reading that in the middle somewhere. We see that a seed develops into a tree. Okay. We follow the line of the process of production at the normal physical level. And we utilize it. We utilize the seed as well as a tree. But we do not discover how a tree can grow out of a seed, how the life and form of a tree come to be implied in the substance or energy of the seed. Or if that be a fact, how the seed can develop into a tree. And now the problem is even more complicated, because even psychological characteristics, which are not even physical, how are they contained in the genes and the chromosomes? We know that genes and chromosomes are the cause of heredity transmissions. not only of physical but psychological variations. But we do not discover how psychological characteristics can be contained and transmitted in this inconscient material vehicle. How does matter produce all these things? We do not see or know, but it is expounded to us as a cogent account of nature process, that a play of electrons, of atoms, and the resultant molecules of cells, glands, chemical secretions, and physiological processes, sometimes being a little ironical, processes managed by their activity on the nerves and the brain of a Shakespeare or a Plato to produce, or could be perhaps the dynamic occasion for the production of a Hamlet or a Symposium or a Republic. Hamlet is written by Shakespeare, Symposium or Republic is written by Plato. Okay, if you remember, there is an interesting sonnet, okay, where he is very, very ironical. Here the irony is suggested, but there the irony is very, very open. Okay, so he says, a committee of glands, okay, on the Aegean Sea wrote the Iliad and the Odyssey. Okay, so that's a poem. Okay, what is the time? Next time I'll read out that poem to you where he's being very, very sarcastic about science, trying to explain that which is not explainable, explanatory, which is not possible. That's basically what he's saying. And you can say, as he's saying, that you can say that the chromosomes, the cause of everything, fine, I've explained everything. But you have explained nothing at all, because who has created the chromosomes? Who has created? So it's not really a cause, it's an intermediate cause, not the ultimate cause. The ultimate cause, it is indeterminate, or is it possible that it is indeterminable? We can never know. That also is a fact if you think of the physical mind. At the physical mind, it is always indeterminable. You cannot know the divine by your mind. You can know the divine by becoming the divine. The consciousness can become that, but the mind consciousness can never know the divine. That's basically what you're saying. The language is a little complex, but the idea is not so complex. We can understand easily. No? When you, two examples that he has given are very, very clear. Okay. Hydrogen and oxygen produces water. Very good. We take it for granted. We also take it for granted that every seed will produce a tree. But how is it doing that? By what magic? That's why Sri Ramza uses the word always. The word used is magician or thaumaturge. Okay. The magician also is used by Shankara. Shankaracharya also uses the word magician. So this is what basically he is saying. So, we have done two paras today.